Dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned to us in the Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. He said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, O you who believe, fear Allah, be mindful of Allah, with the fear that is His exclusive right, and do not allow death to overtake you while you are in some other condition other than in submission to Him. Our talk this evening is about death. Death has been mentioned by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as Qiyama as-Sughra, the small Qiyama, the first stage of Qiyama. And I admit to you that death is not something very easy to talk about. It may be easy to say, may be easy to spell. It may be easy just to hear someone died, but to really think about death or to talk about death, it is not a very easy thing to do. And one of the things I would recommend to you, sometime near to this time, go to a place where there's no one, just you. Cut off all the lights. Pull all the plugs. Take the phone off the hook. Close the blinds. Lock the doors. And then you go inside of a closet and lock that closet. And stay there for 1 hour and think about death in darkness. Because that closet, you'll be standing in that closet, but it'll be just like the same size as the grave that you're going to be laying in soon. And some of the righteous people, because they wanted to understand death in respect to life, they wanted to understand the scenario of death, they used to go to the graveyards and dig a grave and sleep in that grave for one night, just to get a feeling of being inside the grave while you're living before your death. We need to think about death before it comes. In between our laughing and talking and eating and drinking and visiting family members and smiling and enjoying and working and piling up, we need to think about death. Because thinking about death, although it is difficult to do, will improve the quality of our lives, how much we may have left. It is a difficult subject to speak about and to think about. However, from time to time, we will have no choice but to be confronted with that very difficult topic. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned to us in the Quran another way. He said, أَلْحَاكُمُ التَّكَاثُرُ حَتَّى زُرْتُمُ الْمَقَابِرُ. He said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, You are busy. You are engaged. And you are diverted from the reality by the piling up of acquisitions and things. Hatta until you visit the graves. Some of the Mufassirin, they said, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Hatta zultumul maqabir, he meant, until you reach your grave, all the piling up is over. Some others, they said, no, it meant each time you visit the grave on behalf of someone else, at that time, a part of the reality comes to you. But no sooner than you leave that grave, the next day, all of a sudden the reality starts to go back. And what we think is the real life starts to come to us. Death is really no stranger. Nor is it a subject that any of us can afford not to think about. Yesterday, someone in this room had someone in their family, close to them, that they know about, die. Tomorrow, someone in this room, someone close to them, near to them, that they know, will die. Some of us that is in this room right now, a year from now, a month from now, a week from now, a day, an hour perhaps, won't be here. But you're not thinking like that. You got so many things to do. We got so many connections, so many appointments, so many plans. People are dying everywhere. Right now, people are dying. But not me. Not you, not us. This is just an academic subject that we're talking about tonight. We want to try, if we can, to bring it home. Let me, for a moment, introduce you to death, so that you know his name, you know his characteristics, you will feel him, you will smell him, you will taste him, you will touch him, you will anticipate him, because death is a reality. Death is the inevitable trauma. It has to come. Death is the grim reaper. Is there a problem, brother?
Turn your phones off.
Brothers and sisters, you're being asked to cut off your mobile phones. That is only just a courtesy and a respect. Just a courtesy and a respect. Death is the grim reaper. Death is the ender of all pleasures. Death is the doorway to the grave. Death is the final reconciler. It will bring everything. It will reconciliate all matters. Death is the modifier. Those who were arrogant, those who were proud, those who were rich, those who were powerful, death will modify them. Death is the rectifier. All things that need to be balanced and brought forward, death will bring them forward. Death is the remover of distinctions. After death, there are no kings, no princes, no heads of state, no important people, no poor people, no rich people, no black, no white, no yellow, no male, no female. Once they hit the grave, they're just rotten flesh. Death is the separator from friends. Friends can't hold on to dead friends. Even dead loved ones are released. No matter how much you love them, you want to get them out of the house. Death is the liquidator of life. Death is the reality of all the doubters, all the atheists, all the communists, all the socialists, all the agnostics, all those who deny, all those who are angry, proud, rebellious, who say, we don't care. Death is the one that will settle their issues. Death is the humbling of the arrogant. Death is the doorway to darkness. Darkness and depression and disease and tragedy and disaster. Death is the announcer of grief. No matter how happy, how proud, how valiant, how enjoyable, how rich, how powerful, how prosperous people are, when death comes through the doorway, it brings grief to all those connected. Death is the transfer of all possessions. The man with the beautiful wife, his wife will be the wife of someone else. She will first be a widow, and then she will be the wife of someone else. The most powerful, the billionaires, the trillionaires, their mouths will be filled with dust, and their billions and trillions will be scattered and shared by all their friends and family who will enjoy their money and grieve over their death. All the houses, all the properties that people pile up all their lives, scheme for, plan for, plot for, work for, die for, at death, it's all gone. Death is the bringer of tears. Death is the snatcher of loved ones. Death is the unexpected visitor. When death knocks on the door, no one can refuse to answer. And it's always at the wrong time. Death is the gather of the family members. Family members who haven't seen each other for 20 years, 30 years, death brings them together. Death is the event that no one can escape. No matter where people are to escape death, death will seek them out. Where they run to, that place they run to is the place they're supposed to die. Death is the destroyer of all dreams. Death is the undeniable evidence. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had no other power over his creatures, death would be enough. And that's why he swears by the time. He says, wala asr. He swears by the time because in time, innal insana lafi khusr. All the human beings, they would be losers. They will lose their life and their property and their position and their prestige they will lose everything that they have acquired. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, except those who had and preserved a contract of faith. And they did actions which were good and sound. And they used to join together to promote the truth and patience and constancy. Death is the end of this life and the beginning of another. For those that will be happy and prosperous, and those that will be miserable and tragic. This is an introduction to death. And now I would like for you to listen for some verses from the Quran, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us about death. Brother Mu'adh, please read the Shaykh.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما كان لنفس أن تموت إلا بإذن الله كتاب
Subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said in the first part of this ayah, and no person can ever die except by Allah's leave. And they will certainly die at an appointed fixed time.
A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim. Kullu nafsin.
He said, everyone shall experience or taste death. And only on the day of resurrection shall you be paid your wages in full. And whosoever is removed away from the fire and admitted to paradise, he indeed is successful. The life of this world is only the enjoyment of deception, a deceiving thing.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم أينما تكونوا يدرككم الموت ولو كنتم في بروج مشيدة.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wheresoever you may be, death will overtake you. Even if you are in fortresses built up strong and high.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. فلولا ولكن لا تبصرون.
says, as a challenge, then why do you not intervene when the soul of the dying person reaches the throat? And at that moment, you are looking on. But we, our angels who take the soul, are nearer to him than you, but you see them not.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم كلا إذا بلغت التراقي وقيل من راق وظن إلى ربك يومئذ المساق.
الله سبحانه وتعالى, he says, nay, when the soul reaches the collarbone, up to the throat in its exit, and when the Quran explains this, it gives us even the sound. وقيل من راق. And it will be said, who can cure him and save him from death? And he, the dying person, will conclude that it was the time of parting. And one leg will be joined with the other leg when that person is wrapped into a shroud and thrown into the ground. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us these signs for us to think about. Dear brothers and sisters, death is no stranger to us, nor is it a subject that any of us can afford not to think about. Death is the opposite of life. And just like life, death is all around us, manifesting itself and making itself known constantly. When we go to the hospital to see our brand new baby, we don't realize it, but downstairs in the hospital, there is the mortuary full of dead bodies. Some are entering and others are leaving. Some are happy and smiling, walking out with the gift of a child in their arms, and others are staying away. No one wants to go to the mortuary. No one wants to enter that place. It is dark, it is cold, it is smelly, and it is the place where the people will sit for some time until they are washed and wrapped and taken to their final resting place. Death is so definite and obvious that our love for living is always shadowed by a fear for dying. No matter how happy we get, how busy we get, how much life we love, it is always shadowed by the thought and the apprehension of death. The very profound thing about death is that death is non-sectarian. No one can claim that because I'm a Christian, I'm a Jew, I'm a Buddhist, I'm a Hindu, I'm a this, I'm that, I'm a Holy Roller, I'm a Pentecostal, I'm a Muslim, I'm a Salafi, I'm a Shafi, I'm a this, I'm a that. Death is non-sectarian. Everybody's going to die. Everybody's going to get a visit from death. And there's a piece of ground, or a piece of earth, or the ocean, or wherever else your body may wind up at, that's a place for all of us to reside. Death is non-denominational. Death is non-prejudicial. Death doesn't have a problem in taking anybody's life. Death is completely oblivious of age. Death takes babies, adolescents, teenagers, young men and women, middle age, old age. Death doesn't care about gender. Death doesn't care about status. Death doesn't care about race. Pretty people, prosperous people, powerful people, and people with great plans, death takes all of them also. Anyone can die at any time, and everyone will die at some time. Death doesn't make appointments, and death has no contingency plans. Death claims individuals, death claims families, death claims groups, and death takes entire nations off the face of the earth, just like that. In the blink of an eye, death claims its victims while they are still in the womb. And death snatches life from others that are fully mature and sends them to their resting place in the tomb. Today is the first day of the rest of our lives, and death is just around the corner, waiting for us in the shadows, one by one. The love of this life and its glitter makes us think that we have plenty of time to plan, play, and enjoy. Most of you thought tonight that you would come and go, but you don't really know. There are people in this room right now that just last week, they went somewhere to see about someone who had died. And one of the people who had went to see about somebody who had died, died. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And it was the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some of us will be on our way from some place that we thought would just be another place. And we said to the people when we left, I'm sorry, I have to leave right now. I've got an appointment. I gotta go. I gotta be somewhere in an hour. I've gotta be somewhere. I gotta see my husband. I gotta pick up my child. I gotta see my wife. I have to this, I have to that. And it never happened. Death caught them in between. Our preoccupation with children, wives, husbands, homes, automobiles, business, personal ambitions, and competing for material acquisitions will allow death to arrive softly, like a thief in the night. Some of us will go to bed, and in the morning, death snuck in and snatched somebody that was inside of our homes. Or we get a phone call. Our mother, our father, our grandmother, our grandfather, our child, our friend, our neighbor, who we saw just yesterday or spoke to, was laughing and talking. Death came that night and snatched him. Some of us sitting here may not be here next year, next month, next week, or for that matter, the next day. Each of us needs to take an inventory and evaluation of our lives while we are able to do so. Fortunate is the person that takes a moment and a deep breath to appreciate and rearrange their lives before that tragic and lonely moment arrives. Fortunate is the human being that is aware of its creator, is grateful, is humble, and striving to discipline themselves and willing to purify themselves. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. A day will come to each of us that we will wish that we had listened, as the Quran says, وَلَوْ كُنَّا نَسْمَعُ أَوْ نَعْقِلُ مَا كُنَّا فِي أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ فَاعْتَرَفُوا بِذَنْبِهِمْ فَصُحْقًا لِأَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. A day will come to each of us that we will wish that we had listened and used our intelligence. We will wish that we had bowed down. We will wish that we had made salah. Those of us that are Muslims by name, Muslims by tongue, Muslims by culture, Muslims by food, those of us that are Muslims and we have not prayed, we keep saying to ourselves, passing by the mosque, hearing the adhan, looking at the Quran sitting on that shelf, watching our mother pray, watching our father pray, seeing somebody else pray, and telling someone else, pray for me, make dua for me. On that day, you will wish that you had made ruku. You will wish that you had made sajda one time. You will wish, we will wish that we had read the Quran. We will wish that we had made tawbah. The door for tawbah was open all of our lives. It was there. All we had to do was wash, pray, and make our amends to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and correct ourselves. But we never did it. We kept saying, inshallah, as if inshallah is a deck of cards. As if inshallah is some kind of special currency. As if inshallah is some kind of guarantee that you're going to live tomorrow. We kept saying, inshallah. But when death comes, it is mashallah. We will wish that we had made Hajj or Umrah. That money you spent on your car, the money you spent on that furniture, the money you spent on this or that, you could have made Hajj or Umrah, but you didn't. You said, inshallah, when I get 60, I'm going to make Hajj. When I get old, I'm going to make Hajj. I'm going to do all these sins, all these wrong things. When I get 60, I'm going to Mecca. I'm going to ask Allah to forgive me. This is what some people are thinking. They sell haram all their life. They live in a haram house all their life. They eat from the haram all their life. They do haram, buy and sell haram all their life. And then they think that they will take $2,000 and they will go make Hajj and all everything will be squared up. Because they are foolish. We will wish that we had paid our debts. We will wish that we had reconciled our differences. How many Muslims do you have a difference with, a problem with, an issue with, an argument with, a vendetta with, a beef that you haven't reconciled? As a matter of fact, many of us, we don't even want to reconcile differences. We put water on the differences. We cultivate the difference. We want to find a reason why not to reconcile with somebody. Even if they made tawbah, even if they came and apologized, we still don't want to accept it because we have hardened ourselves against reconciling with that person. But we will wish that we had reconciled our differences. We will wish that we had paid zakat. You will wish that you took the time to compute your zakat and that you found somebody to pay it. You would wish that you had given away something in sadaqah. We will wish that we had gave up our bad habits. We will wish that we had not procrastinated and delayed. We will wish that day had never came. But that day will come. but it will be too late. Death will come like a lost breath. Death will come like a massive stroke. Death will come as a total paralysis. Death may come while you're sleeping, or death may come in the middle of your busiest activities. Dear brothers and sisters, Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, he mentioned that the Prophet used to pray, "A'udhu bi izzatika alladhi la ilaha illa ant, alladhi la yamut, wal ins wal jinn yamutun." He used to say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "I seek refuge in your power, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one whom there is no God except you, the one who never dies, while the humans and the jinn are those who will die." The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to take the soul of a person in a certain land, He causes him to have a need to go there." And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said that Habiba, one of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, "Oh Allah, let me enjoy my husband, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my father Abu Sufyan, and my brother Muawiyah," that is, radiallahu anhu, "do not let them die before me." She made this dua. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he heard her, and he said, "You have asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about a time which is already appointed, and days which are already numbered, and provisions which is already shared out. Allah does not hasten to do anything before its appointed time, and He does not delay anything until after its appointed time. If you had asked Allah to protect you from the torment of hell and the punishment of the grave, that would have been better for you." Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I remind you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says to us in Surah Al-Mulk, "A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan rajeem, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, tabaraka alladhi biyadihi al-mulk, wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir, alladhi khalaqa al-mawta wal-hayata liyabluwakum ayyukum ahsanu amala." He mentions, subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Glory be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in whose hands there is all the dominion, all the power. It is He who created the death and also created the life in order to see which one of us would be the best in our behavior. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this medicine be of a benefit to me and to you. We ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this reminder be one that causes you and I to reflect. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He benefit us with remembrance of Him in this life, and that He cause us to think often about death before it comes to us. Wa qulu qawli hadha wa astaghfiru rabbakum subhanahu wa ta'ala.